Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the gallery of St. Mark's Cathedral in Seattle. I've just played Widor's Toccata, the last movement of his fifth symphony for organ. In a few minutes, I will play his tenth and last symphony, the Symphonie Romane. I learned this organ symphony during Lent in 1992. It was my Lenten discipline that year, and I first performed it on Easter Sunday. I've performed it regularly in the 28 years since then, and each time I prepare it for another performance, I fall deeper in love with it. Before I play it this evening, I'm going to offer a 10-minute talk about Widor, the symphony, and its context in the cultural life of Paris in the 1890s. Then I'll take about 3 minutes to describe and play some themes for you to listen for. Then we'll get to the music making. I also included brief notes in the printed program. They provide essential information and a sort of a movement-by-movement description of the music. That program is accessible via a link on your screen just above this video. So if you're here for music and not for talk, this might be a good time to go make yourself a nice hot cup of tea or pour yourself a tall glass of your favorite beverage, and be sure to come back in about 10 minutes. Widor was born in Lyon into a family of organ builders. At age 24, he was appointed assistant organist to Camille Saint-Saëns at the Church of the Madeleine in Paris. Just 1 year later, he was appointed chief organist of Saint-Sulpice, Paris, still regarded today as the most important post for a French organist. He remained there for 60 years. Dr. Albert Schweitzer was among Widor's organ students, and in 1912, teacher and student collaborated on an annotated edition of the complete works of Johann Sebastian Bach for organ. Widor is best known today for his 10 organ symphonies, but he also composed 4 operas, 17 orchestral works, 21 chamber works, and dozens of piano pieces and songs. As organist of Saint-Sulpice, Widor's primary role was to improvise music before, during, and after services on the large pipe organ in the rear gallery of the church. Typically, another organist accompanied the chanted parts of the service on a smaller organ near the high altar. During the 1870s, when Gabriel Fauré was the chant organist at Saint-Sulpice, the two musicians frequently had renowned improvisation competitions. Naturally, Gregorian chant formed the basis of their music making. From what his contemporaries wrote about hearing Widor improvise, I think we can hear the Symphonie Romane as a written-out improvisation and a very sophisticated one. It is a window into the world of turn-of-the-century Parisian organist composers and the instruments they played. Symphonie Romane means Romanesque symphony. It is so named because of its relationship to the Basilica of Saint-Sernin in Toulouse, an 11th century building that remains to this day the largest Romanesque church in Europe. Widor dedicated his Symphonie Romane to the memory of Saint-Sernin, the saint for whom that basilica is named. One of the links between Widor and the Romanesque Basilica in Toulouse is, of course, the pipe organ, built there in 1890 by Aristide Cavaillé-Cole. You could say that what Stradivarius is to violinists, Cavaillé-Cole is to organists. He pioneered methods of organ engineering and construction that allowed for an unprecedented range of expression available to the organist. Widor greatly admired his work, and as chief organist at Saint-Sulpice, Widor played the largest of Cavaillé-Cole's instruments every Sunday. Several late 19th century artistic currents run through this music. One is the rise of cyclic form. a technique of musical construction involving multiple sections or movements in which a theme or melody recurs among all movements as a unifying feature. Modest examples would include César Franck's Grande Pièce Symphonique for organ of 1862, Tchaikovsky's Fourth Symphony of 1878, and Debussy's String Quartet in G minor of 1893. A monumental example, of course, is Richard Wagner's Ring Cycle, 20 hours of musical drama in four operas that share common musical themes. In Symphonie Romane, Widor ties the movements together with a Gregorian chant associated with Easter Day. And in an incredibly beautiful gesture, Widor closes the whole symphony with the same music with which it begins, literally bringing us full circle. Speaking of Wagner, his music was very much in the air in the last decade of the 19th century in Paris. In 1895, Widor himself remarked, "Since the beginning of the current season in Paris, we have been able to hear I don't know how many love deaths or rides of the Valkyries." He's referring to Wagner's operas, the Tristan und Isolde and Die Walküre. The Symphonie Romane is infused with Wagner's harmonic language. Another significant influence is Impressionist art. The first major exhibition of Impressionist art was in Paris in 1897, just 2 years before this symphony was composed. Impressionist painters placed a high value on capturing a moment, submitting to the first impression of what they saw around them, rather than trying to mold it into a classical form. Yet another influence is literary symbolism. The Symbolist Manifesto of 1886, published in the French newspaper Le Figaro, states that literary symbolism was hostile to plain meanings, declamations, false sentimentality, and matter-of-fact description, and that its goal was instead to represent absolute truths symbolically through metaphorical images and language. The composer Claude Debussy was deeply inspired by this literary movement, in particular by the poet Stéphane Mallarmé, whose poem Afternoon of a Faun inspired Debussy's famous tone poem Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun. That work was given its premiere in Paris just 5 years before Widor composed Symphonie Romane. It is music untethered to classical forms. Debussy describes it as a succession of scenes through which pass the desires and dreams of the faun in the heat of the afternoon. Similarly, Symphonie Romane eludes classical formal analysis. I think it is best enjoyed as a series of beautiful sonic landscapes in which Gregorian chant, Wagnerian harmony, and French organ sonorities unite to represent the holy and the eternal. In a typical four-movement symphony, one of the two middle movements will be a scherzo or some other lively genre. Not so here. If I were forced to identify anything about this symphony that brings me up short, it is that the second and third movements present as two slow movements in a row. Nevertheless, one of the things that does make these two middle movements distinct from one another is a change of tone color. I encourage you to listen for this. The second movement features the many beautiful flute stops of this organ. In contrast, the third movement features the clarinet stop, a set of pipes in the highest section of the organ case. They are in a box with louvers that I can open and close with a foot pedal here at the console to vary the intensity and presence of the pipe's sound. Here's another element to listen for. In addition to that large circle that brings us back to our starting place, there are many smaller circles in this music, wheels within wheels, as it were. The proper term for this is ostinato, which is related to our English word obstinate. They are musical passages in which a small motive is played over and over. They are like a meditation mantra, and for me, they are a big part of the magic of this music. Let me give you just a few examples. In the first movement, after a climactic full organ statement of the chant theme, fragments of it are developed in a sparkling texture in the hands, under which the pedals play this ostinato. And so forth, like a big wheel turning. Incidentally, that bears a strong resemblance to an ostinato figure in the closing scene of Wagner's Die Walküre. It's the melodic fragment associated with the sleeping spell cast upon Brünnhilde by her father Wotan when he places her on a rock surrounded by magic fire that only a true hero can penetrate. Here's that ostinato figure. See if you can even tell a difference. I don't think the resemblance is an accident. Here's an ostinato figure that appears in the second movement, also in the pedals. You get the idea. It's based on a countermelody in the second movement, a countermelody to the primary chant theme, and that countermelody sounds like this. As the energy of the final climax in the last movement subsides, you will hear this ostinato. It's derived from the main theme of the whole symphony, which sounds like this. Now, about that main theme. As I said earlier, it is a Gregorian chant for Easter, the first line of which is Ec dies quam fecit Dominus, this day is made by the Lord. It is the thread from which the whole symphony is woven, except the third movement. That movement, with its long clarinet solo, is a meditation on another Easter chant, Victime Paschali Laudes Immolent Christiani, let Christians offer praises as sacrifice to the paschal victim. We are very blessed this evening to have with us three singers from the Compline Choir, Jason Anderson, its director, and Gregory Block and James Wilcox. They are in the northeast corner of the cathedral on the floor right now, the so-called Compline Corner. And before I play the symphony, they will offer both of these Easter chants in their entirety and in the version commonly known among Parisian Roman Catholics in Widor's day. The symphony takes about 36 minutes to play. It ends in a mood of deep fulfillment and serenity. Rather than break that spell, we will savor it in silence for a moment and then fade to darkness. I'm grateful to be joined here tonight not only by the trio from the Compline Choir, but also by Chris Brown, our live stream guru, and Roger Sherman, who is here optimizing our audio feed. Roger is the Associate Organist Emeritus at St. Mark's Cathedral and host of the Organ Loft radio program. We're very grateful to him also for sponsoring this evening's concert. On behalf of our Dean, the Very Reverend Stephen Thomason, and all of us here at St. Mark's, thank you very much for being with us this evening.
Oh. Thank you.